Good day from the International Space Station Flight Control Room at the Johnson Space Center in Houston as another week begins aboard the Orbital Laboratory for the Expedition 33 crew. Here in the ISS Flight Control Room, the Orbit 2 team of flight controllers is on duty at this hour, having taken a handover earlier today from the Orbit 1 team that presided over the first half of the crew workday that began with a wake-up call at 1 a.m. Central Time. On console at this hour, tending to business along with other flight control teams around the world, are the Orbit 2 flight director on the right side of your screen, Mike Lammers, joined on console by spacecraft communicator Mark Reagan, who is talking directly to the crew on board the International Space Station. That Expedition 33 crew, led by Station Commander Sonny Williams on the left of your screen, along with Russian cosmonaut Yuri Malenchenko in the middle and Aki Hoshide, the flight engineer from the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, are in their 78th day in space, their 76th day aboard the International Space Station. A few minutes ago, Sonny Williams reported to the flight control team here on the ground that the crew is gliding through what she called a manic Monday, where they're working a couple of in-flight maintenance issues, nothing of any tremendous significance, but those issues include the replacement earlier today of a Pretreat tank in the waste and hygiene compartment that is located in the Destiny Laboratory of the International Space Station. You're looking at video that was acquired at about 3 a.m. Central Time on Monday. Sonny Williams working to reinstall a brand new pretreat tank that is essential for the operation of that waste and hygiene compartment in the Destiny Laboratory. The R&R of that tank, which is conducted periodically, was of no consequence, but the problem occurred with the attempt to reactivate the system, which yielded no joy. Specialists are off scratching their heads and developing troubleshooting plans as they pour through the data from the waste and hygiene compartment before offering any further recommendations to the space station crew on board the International Space Station for another attempt to reactivate the waste and hygiene compartment. One of the options may be to change out that tank. It's possible that a bad set of pretreat liquid may be existing in that tank that was replaced by Williams earlier today. We'll be waiting for further words on the disposition of the reactivation of the waste and hygiene compartment. One of the other issues that Williams faced in the early morning hours was the reloading of software on Express Rack 2 in the Destiny Laboratory. You're looking here at video of a laptop computer that she attempted to reload software on for the governing of experiment data coming down from that Express Rack. The activity that took about an hour this morning yielded no joy either in the loading of that new software for Express Rack 2. And as a result, the Payload Operations Center at the Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama, that is responsible for payload operations aboard the Orbital Laboratory, is off considering what other options may be necessary and any troubleshooting activities that may be in work to try to successfully load new software in Express Rack 2. The old load of software is operating just fine. No impact to science at this point, as Sonny Williams and the payload team at the Marshall Space Flight Center are off discussing any options for the next attempt to reload new software in Express Rack 2. One of the items on tap for this first day of October is the start of a busy week of activities in preparation for the scheduled launch on Sunday evening of the SpaceX Dragon vehicle from Launch Complex 40 at the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station in Florida, the second flight of the Dragon spacecraft to the International Space Station, and the first commercial resupply mission to the International Space Station, carrying a significant amount, about 1,000 pounds of experiments and supplies for the residents of the International Space Station. Over the weekend, SpaceX team down at the Cape successfully conducted a hot fire test of the Falcon 9 launch vehicle's first stage Merlin engines. They are poring over that data throughout the course of the day. Everything appears to have gone well with that hot fire test. Other internal reviews are underway by the SpaceX technicians and engineers down at Launch Complex 40. And a further review and a final poll for a go, no-go for Sunday's launch will be taken to the International Space Station Mission Management Team this coming Thursday. If all goes as planned, the Falcon 9 will lift off from the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station at 7:35 p.m. Central Time, 8:35 p.m. Eastern Time on Sunday night. That will set up a rendezvous that will take just a bit over 2 days, enabling the Dragon to reach the vicinity of the International Space Station on Wednesday, October 10th, for a grapple that by the station's robotic arm, the Canadarm2, that will be operated by Aki Hoshide and Sonny Williams from the Cupola Robotic Workstation in the International Space Station, as was the case back in May for the maiden flight of Dragon to the International Space Station on a demonstration flight that also carried a small amount of cargo to the complex. This time, they will reach out, grapple the Dragon and berth it to the Earth-facing port on the Harmony module of the International Space Station for just under 3 weeks of berthed operations to unload that cargo and load supplies and experiments back into Dragon for its return to Earth and a splashdown off the coast of Southern California that is scheduled for October 28th. Our live coverage on Sunday night, originating from the Kennedy Space Center and the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, of the SpaceX Dragon launch on that first commercial resupply mission is scheduled for 6 p.m. Central Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Again, the launch is scheduled on an instantaneous launch window at 7:35 p.m. Central Time, 8:35 p.m. Eastern Time on Sunday night, October 7th. To that end, Williams and Hoshide will be using a laptop computer in the Destiny Laboratories robotic workstation today in order to conduct a robotic training exercise using a pre-loaded program to simulate the arrival of Dragon and their simulated grapple and berthing of the Dragon spacecraft to the nadir port or the Earth-facing port of Harmony. The issue with that robotics workstation in the Destiny Laboratory that also continues to be under technical discussion was the unsuccessful attempt on Friday to replace a remote power control module, an RPCM, if you will, that is used for the routing of electrical power to that robotics workstation. An attempt to replace the current RPCM with a spare was not successful. A second spare was also attempted to be installed by Sonny Williams. It too was not successful in a power-up of that new RPCM. And so the old remote power control module was reinstalled in the Destiny Laboratory. It is up and running, establishing communications, but there is no indication of a power flow to that unit. As a result, to ensure that a redundant power supply goes to that robotics workstation, the crew will be installing on Tuesday a jumper cable to make sure that the lab robotics workstation, one of two that exist in the International Space Station, has a redundant power capability and is available to the crew as a hot backup to their Cupola workstation, robotics workstation that they will be operating out of on October 10th for the grapple and berthing of the Dragon spacecraft. Amidst all of this, scientific experiments continue on board the International Space Station. One of the experiments in work today is called the In-Space Experiment. The principal investigators for that are Dr. Alice Gast of MIT and Dr. Eric First of the University of Delaware. The In-Space Experiment, that's a fancy acronym for investigating the structure of paramagnetic aggregates from colloidal emulsions, basically studies the behavior of magnetic colloidal fluids under the influence of various magnetic fields. The technology and data gleaned from this experiment is designed to improve the ability to design structures such as bridges and buildings and to better withstand earthquake damage to structures by formulating better structures and better materials with which to build buildings back on Earth. While all this is going on, another spacecraft continues to orbit the Earth, that being the Eduardo Amaldi automated transfer vehicle that undocked from the International Space Station from the aft port of the Zvezda service module back on Friday afternoon at 4:44 p.m. Central Time over western Kazakhstan, ending a six-month stay on board the International Space Station. The belated undocking of Eduardo Amaldi occurred 3 days behind schedule because of a communications glitch between service module software and the automated transfer vehicle. That was solved by Russian flight controllers, permitting the undocking to occur back on Friday. Eduardo Amaldi has continued to move away, to phase away from the International Space Station to a safe distance for what is expected to be a pair of deorbit burns, engine firings, if you will, retrograde engine firings on Tuesday afternoon and Tuesday evening that will send Eduardo Amaldi into a reentry into the Earth's atmosphere where it will burn up harmlessly over the Pacific Ocean. This animation shows essentially the reentry of Eduardo Amaldi and its breakup over the Pacific Ocean. A special recording device will measure the data from that breakup and send back information to engineers and scientists on the ground who are developing spacecraft of the future so they better understand the breakup characteristics of a space vehicle that is re-entering the Earth's atmosphere. And so that's a look ahead at what's happening aboard the International Space Station and a look at some of the activities that lie ahead in the days for the Expedition 33 crew.